Prime Minister Narendra Modi is going to be holding a meeting with district magistrates of the districts that have a low vaccination coverage. And this is going to be rather very crucial because there are several districts in this country that have got a rather low percentage of vaccine coverage of the first and second dose. And that's a matter of huge concern. This is a virtual meeting that is going to be including districts with less than 50% coverage of the first dose and coverage of the second COVID vaccine as well. The Prime Minister will be interacting with DMs of over 40 districts in Jharkhand, Manipur, Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, Maharashtra, Meghalaya, and the chief ministers of these states are going to be present at this particular meeting. The Prime Minister Modi's review meeting is coming just days after Health Minister Mansukh Mandavia informed that 12 crore people have not taken their second dose of vaccine as yet. Till now, 73.7 crore first doses, that covers 78% of the eligible population, and 33.5 crore doses, which is second doses, that covers 35.2% of the eligible population, have been administered with the vaccines. But the low coverage of vaccines in the districts that I just mentioned earlier and the states I just mentioned earlier remains to be a huge concern as far as the country is concerned. Joining us live for the very latest on this particular story, Milan, I'm throwing straight across to you to walk our viewers through the ground reality of the low vaccine coverage that we're seeing across several states in India, and what are the reasons why there is a low vaccination coverage in certain districts and certain states in this country?
Well, Chaiti, this has been one of the conundrums for the Indian government, because remember, those who have taken Covishield, they still have to wait for about 84 days after taking the first jab to take the second jab. Those who have taken Covaxin can still take it within 28 days or 30 days. But the majority of the population in the country, at least more than 85% people, are inoculated with Serum Institute of India's Covishield, where the dose gap is higher. This is also a concern for India, because as long as people will not take their second dose, the vaccination will not be complete. So you need to be fully vaccinated. And hence, the country will not even be able to reach the target to inoculate all eligible population before the end of this year, as earlier stated by the Union Health Minister, as well as Prime Minister Narendra Modi, which is why the Prime Minister will himself speak to district magistrates of more than 40 districts that are reporting lower vaccination coverages. There are multiple reasons why people are not taking their vaccine. Some are delaying taking the vaccine, which is not right, and which is why these DMs will be told to carry out door-to-door vaccination campaigns, check with households where second doses have not been taken, and note down their problems, all and right. Then bring them to a vaccination center to make sure that India is inoculated fully.
All right. Thanks, Milan, for joining us with the very latest details on this particular story. Continue to be with us right there. As all eyes are now on the World Health Organization, India's indigenously developed Covaxin is seeking an emergency use approval from the WHO, the World Health Organization. They're going to be meeting to assess emergency use approval for Covaxin. The technical advisory group of WHO will discuss and assess the final risk benefit needed for approval of Covaxin. Over 12% of total vaccinated Indians have got Covaxin, and a WHO nod will enable them to travel abroad without the need for quarantine. Prime Minister Modi at G20 meeting in Italy categorically said that emergency approval for Covaxin will help India in assisting other countries to vaccinate their population. Prime Minister Modi also said that India is ready to produce over 5 billion COVID vaccine doses by the end of next year to help the world in the fight against coronavirus. So far, 11 countries, including Australia, have approved the Covaxin jab. Sneha Mordani now joins us for the very latest. She's been tracking these developments rather very closely. Sneha, what is your sense? Why is there a delay of the WHO approval for the India's indigenously developed Covaxin? What are the reasons that are being cited for this particular delay by the WHO scientifically?
Well, you know, Chaiti, very good morning to you first. The WHO has clearly said that they are waiting more data from Bharat Biotech. And we've been given to understand by the company that they have submitted all the data, including the data that was sought about gender-wise distribution in administering the vaccination, and also data that was provided as far as immunogenicity is concerned, efficacy data. Now, all of that, the company says that has been submitted. In fact, the last time around also when the meeting took place on the 26th of October, the same reasons were cited by the WHO for further delay in holding the meeting. This is the technical advisory group saying that we're waiting for more data from the company here in question. Well, the Indian Council of Medical Research and Bharat Biotech, who have jointly developed Covaxin, India's indigenous vaccine, has now finally said that whatever information was sought has been given by the company in question here, and that they're awaiting a nod from the World Health Organization. But it's interesting to note how the WHO has time and again sort of taken, you know, pains to underscore that they're not going to be cutting corners. Something that they've said in the past as well, that there is a process and that we are going to be following all the due processes in giving emergency use listing for Covaxin. Remember, even when the approval does come through, the EUL was only going to be applicable for those above the age of 18 and not for the younger population for which the vaccine has already got an approval, at least by the subject expert committee in India. Back home in India also, when it comes to approval for kids, the vaccine is has made little progress, given that the Drugs Controller General of India has not yet given approval to vaccines of Covaxin for use in kids between the age of 2 to 18. So there's a concern back home and outside of India as well. Now, right from perception building to ensuring commercial exports of these vaccines, commercial dealings of these vaccines, ensuring that Covaxin then goes to Covovax, which is a central platform of supply, there are a lot many reasons why this emergency use listing of Covaxin is extremely important. There are vaccines that have been used before Covaxin, like Sputnik V, for example, and that hasn't got EUL just yet.
Absolutely. And as you mentioned, Sneha, that the WHO has time and again underscored the fact that they will continue to follow the due process as far as the approval is concerned. India is waiting for the WHO nod at the moment for Covaxin. Let's get you the efficacy data now of Covaxin on your screens right now. Let's bring you how effective is Covaxin. Studies have been conducted in over 26,000 volunteers in the development of the indigenous Covaxin. Symptomatic disease, the efficacy stands at 77% for Covaxin, and for severe disease also it is rather effective, because it is 93% efficacy is what it's showing for severe disease. As far as Delta variant is concerned, 65% efficacy for the Delta variant. And when it comes to Covishield, AstraZeneca and Serum Institute of India, it has been approved by the World Health Organization, and many in India who have taken this are already traveling. The problem is with Covaxin, people who have taken the Covaxin jabs, they are not being able to travel. Bharat Biotech has made this, but the WHO clearance is awaited, and hence traveling is becoming a problem in many countries. Then you have the Sputnik V, which is the Russian one, which is RDIF. It has not been approved by WHO still. Moderna, approved by the WHO. Then you've got the other vaccine, which is Janssen, which is made by Johnson & Johnson, as you already know. That has an approval of the World Health Organization as well. Let's get you the latest as far as the Deepavali celebrations in Ayodhya are concerned. Over 9 lakh diyas are going to be lit in Ayodhya. It's the holy city which is readying itself for the Diwali celebrations. It's going to be celebrating the festival of lights. On your screens at the moment are visuals from Yogi Adityanath's previous Diwali celebrations in Ayodhya. This year is going to indeed be special, as the Ram Temple is city is decked up for mega festivities. The city of Ayodhya is being lit up with more than 9 lakh diyas. This is the first time that festivities have been scaled up to this level and administration has sought assistance of 12,000 volunteers. There are plans for a laser show, sound, light show, use of drones, 3D projection of the Ramayana. 500 drones will draw various events from the Ramayana on Ayodhya skyline. 3D holographic shows and projection mappings also highlight the celebrations. And Ayodhya is lit up. Ayodhya is welcoming the Festival of Lights. Lots lined up for the celebrations on your screens right now. 9 lakh diyas are going to be lit. They're going to be creating a world record of sorts. Sound and light show lined up in the holy city of Ayodhya. 500 drones in 3D to draw events from Ramayana. 3D holographic shows and projection mapping has also been planned in Ayodhya. And that is all that's lined up for Diwali in Ayodhya. And as the battle for 2022 heats up, Ayodhya is now at the center of the political storm ahead of the UP elections. All the political parties campaigning rather very hard. It's going to be a hard-fought battle right there. And UP Chief Minister has also visited the holy temple town multiple times. Samajwadi Party, BSP, AAP, everyone is making temple runs. Take a look.
Does the road to Lucknow go via Ayodhya? It certainly seems so in pole-bound Uttar Pradesh. With an eye on the crucial upcoming elections, political parties are rushing to the hallowed ground of Ayodhya. Lord Ram's birthplace has become the new arena to get political mileage. From Uttar Pradesh Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath to the Aam Aadmi Party's Arvind Kejriwal to the BSP's Satish Chandra Mishra, all are seeking Ram's blessings. Aam Aadmi Party Supremo Arvind Kejriwal has announced a free Ayodhya pilgrimage if elected to power. The party had earlier taken out a Tiranga Yatra in many parts of the state.
प्रभु से मांगे हैं एक तो अपने देश की लोगों के लिए सुख शांति देश का विकास और दूसरा कि प्रभु मुझे क्षमता दे और प्रभु मुझे ताकत दे कि मैं ज्यादा से ज्यादा देशवासियों को यहां पे लाके उनके दर्शन करा सकूं
लॉन्चिंग अ स्टेट वाइड ब्राह्मण कॉन्फ्रेंस इन अयोध्या ऑन जुलाई द 23rd Bahujan Samaj Party National General Secretary and close Mayawati aide Satish Chandra Mishra said the BJP had been raising funds for the construction of the Ram Temple for the last 20 years but has not been able to build it.
जब 2022 में पूर्ण बहुमत की सरकार बनेगी तो मैं ये आप लोगों को आश्वासन देता हूं विश्वास दिलाता हूं कि इनके पास जो हजारों हजारों लाखों करोड़ों रुपए इन्होंने जमा कर रखे हैं और जिसका इस्तेमाल ये नहीं कर रहे हैं भगवान श्री राम के मंदिर बनाने के लिए और मंदिर नहीं बनाना चाहते हैं इनको मजबूर हम लोग करेंगे कि एक यहां पर भव्य मंदिर जो बनने का काम
यूपी चीफ मिनिस्टर योगी आदित्यनाथ ऑन हिज पार्ट हैज डिस्क्राइब्ड द ग्रैंड राम टेंपल अंडर कंस्ट्रक्शन एज एन अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर 135 करोड़ इंडियंस टू होल्ड देयर हेड्स हाई बिफोर द वर्ल्ड
जो लोग कल तक राम को काल्पनिक कहते थे आज उन्होंने हमारी वैचारिक प्रतिबद्धता के साथ जुड़ते हुए उन्होंने भी कहना शुरू कर दिया कि राम तो हमारे भी है तो हमने कहा कब हमने कहा कि तुम्हारे नहीं है हम तो पहले से इस बात को कहते थे तुम और तुम्हारे पूर्वज गलत थे माफी मांगो देश से
द समाजवादी पार्टी टू लॉन्च्ड अ कैंपेन ऑन सितंबर 3rd फ्रॉम अयोध्या
सहयोग कीजिए और आखिर की आजादी की जंग जीतिए आपका जीत के पोलिंग के दिन आप सारा का सारा वोट समाजवादी पार्टी के पक्ष में दिलाना यही मैं प्रार्थना करने आया हूँ
Congress General Secretary Priyanka Gandhi Vadra is yet to visit Ayodhya but offered prayers at the Kashi Vishwanath Temple and Durga Temple in Varanasi. The Congress General Secretary also recited two shlokas in Sanskrit and urged the audiences to chant Jai Mata Di at her Varanasi rally. Political pundits see the temple runs by opposition leaders as a bid to breach the BJP's Hindutva vote bank ahead of the crucial Uttar Pradesh election. Bureau Report, India Today.
And Thalaivar is back with a bang. Rajinikanth's Anathe releases tomorrow. Fans will be gearing up for this big release, given the fact that it is releasing in over 1,100 theatres across the state. And we are getting you all the details in terms of what the movie is all about. It's got action, it's got drama, it's got humour and so much more. Take a look.
It's the Rajni Diwali dhamaka everyone is waiting for. The Thalaivar is back on the silver screen this Thursday. The Rajinikanth starrer Anathe promises to be a cracker of a movie. The 230 crore film set in a rural background will have all the ingredients of a thriller with action, drama, humor and lilting music, and it has an ensemble cast comprising Nayantara, Kirti Suresh and Prakash Raj. The much-awaited release comes days after Rajinikanth returned home from hospital after a minor surgery.
Chikitsai mudindathu naan nalla irukken nik night da naan vandu veettukku vandha enakku vandu ennoda aarogyathukaga prarthanai seidha ella
Thalaivar's fans are ecstatic, even more so after the Tamil Nadu government allowed 100% occupancy in theatre.
I would put Anathe as a big ticket movie. It's coming for Deepavali. Basic thing here is that Rajinikanth is a very big star, one of the biggest stars ever. And he is releasing Anathe in Tamil and Telugu and also worldwide it is going. I think it will have around 1,500 screens. It's going to go maybe when 2,000 screens it will be there.
With a new Rajni film hitting the screens on Diwali, it could be a win-win for all. Cinema owners, distributors and fans. With Akshaya Nath in Chennai, Bureau Report, India Today.
The Delhi Commission of Women has now issued a notice to the Delhi police over the online trolls and threats that Virat Kohli's 9-month-old daughter is receiving. She's receiving rape threats only because Virat Kohli stood up by his teammate Mohammad Shami. Take a look at this report.
It all began with Indian speedster Mohammad Shami being abused on internet. Shami became the target of trolls after India's humiliating loss against Pakistan. Indian skipper Virat Kohli was among many who called out the communal trolls, saying Shami is one of the finest cricketers India had produced.
To me, you know, attacking someone over their religion is the most, I would say, pathetic thing that a human being can do. We stand by him fully. We are backing him 200%, and all those who have attacked him can come with more force if they want to. Our brotherhood, our friendship within the team, and nothing can be shaken.
After India's rout against New Zealand, the online trolling was directed at the skipper. It took the most disgusting turn when trolls threatened Virat Kohli's 9-month-old daughter, Vamika, in the vilest and most barbaric way. The tweet, as we speak, stands deleted. But the Delhi Commission of Women has issued a notice to Delhi Police's cybercrime unit seeking FIR against rape threats to a 9-month-old.
Criminal-minded people are around us, and probably we don't even know who they are. Most of the time, cybercrimers actually get away with all the hate mongering that they do, all the threat that they make, nothing sort of happens to them.
Choti si bachchi hai aur uske bare mein koi soch is tarike ki pure desh mein banayega aur aisi baat karega, wo kaise India mein reh sakta hai? Bharat mein rehne ke kabil nahi hai wo vyakti jisne is tarike ka ट्वीट किया है या मैसेजेस किए हैं, जो भी उन लोगों ने किया है वो बहुत बड़ा क्राइम किया है. मैं कहती हूँ जल्दी से जल्दी ढूंढ के उनको फटाफट उनको सजा दी जाए.
Activists too have demanded the strictest of action.
These right-leaning people are so bothered about Pakistan, India losing to Pakistan. They must be worried about the human trafficking that is happening, buying and selling of children that is happening every day. I think the police needs to identify these people, register an FIR and put them in jail. No court should be lenient towards these people.
On Tuesday, Congress MP Rahul Gandhi took to Twitter to back Virat. At a time when people are being jailed in the country for comments against politicians, the onus is now on police to hunt out and punish the people behind violent threats on the social media. Bureau Report, India Today.
That's it from me, Chaiti Narula, on this bulletin.